we will get dizzy with the joy of worshiping. Psalm 100 says, shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful singing. Know that the Lord Himself is God. It is He who has made us and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. So enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His holy name. For the Lord is good, His loving kindness is everlasting, and His faithfulness to all generations. Amen? Amen. Let's sing aloud of our love to Him. My Jesus, I love Thee. I know Thou art mine. For Thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior,
favorite lines I have in that song is about the purchase that Jesus made of us with that cross. So many times we think of God's grace as free that we forget the price of the grace. The price is not what we paid. The price is what God paid to give it to us. The significance of the gift is not what you and I do. It's what the giver did in order for it to happen. And when we think about the things that we pay along the way, when we think about the cost of our obedience, when we think about the cost of a quiet time today, when there's so much to do today, when we think about the cost of the discipline of prayer, When we think about the cost of the discipline of righteousness and holiness, you measure that cost against that free gift, that gift of grace, and you understand we could never pay a dime's worth back of the price God paid for our free salvation. It is free, but it isn't cheap. I'm going to ask Dr. Norris Grubbs if he would come and join me here at the platform. One of the programs we're so thrilled about at New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary is our Level College program. More than a third of our students, or almost a half of our students, are enrolled in various forms of our undergraduate program. It has been one of the best opportunities for us to diversify our student population and bring in a lot of different ethnic groups for theological education and training. They do a wonderful work. God has been blessing that program in so many ways. Dr. Grubbs teaches New Testament for us in Level College, and we're so excited to have him as a part of our seminary family. Dr. Grubbs, would you please lead us in a word of prayer?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you today, to pause in the midst of busy schedules and midterms and anxiety and worry, and to just be in your presence. And I pray that today, as we are in your presence, we might be calmed by that. We might be changed by that. I pray as we hear your word, Lord, that our hearts might become more like yours. I pray you give us the courage and the boldness to be obedient to what you show us today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Before you sit down, turn to somebody and just remind them, it is free, but it isn't cheap. Would you do that, please? Thank you so very much. We do welcome you to this time of worship and praise on the campus of New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. What a great week. We've been enjoying in chapel this week. Today will be no exception. We're delighted to have with us Dr. Tony Lambert, who is pastor of Cross Gates Baptist Church in Brandon, Mississippi. And it's been a while since we've been able to have a pop test of any of our preachers. And since Brother Tony is one of our graduates, one of our alumni, and made just wonderful grades while he was a student, I know that he has perfect recall of everything he learned. And so, Brother Tony, would you please come and join me up here? Our seminary family loves it when we give pop tests in chapel from time to time. It gives them hope when they have to take those Hebrew tests. And so we're going to run through just a few conjugations like that. Okay? Very good. Are you ready to go?
I'm ready.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Here we go.
Okay.
Now, Brother Tony, your church previous to Cross Gates Baptist Church was what church?
That would be Westside Baptist Church.
Baptist Church. Okay, we're glad to get the word Baptist in there. We usually have Baptist preachers in here. And where was it located?
It was in Omaha, Nebraska.
Ah, outside the Bible Belt. So you were a mission church pastor and all that. Tell us, what size was the church when you got there?
About 1,000 in worship.
About 1,000 worship. You mean they have churches more than 100 people when you get north of the Mason-Dixon line?
There are some people out there, yes.
There are some people out there. And what size was the church when you left?
We ran close to 4,000 in worship.
Now, wait a minute. I thought you said you're in Nebraska.
We weren't.
And you had a church with more than 4,000 people in Nebraska?
Yes.
How in the world were you reaching people up there?
The same way you reach them anywhere.
No.
Yes.
Tell us some of the things that you did in your outreach program.
Well, we poured a lot of energy into evangelism, just doing some things to reach people, just calling our people to biblical evangelism, getting involved in personal evangelism. Did a lot of events, those kinds of things as well. But, you know, the truth is people were hungry for the truth.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're now in Mississippi at Cross Gates Baptist Church in Brandon, which is a suburb of Jackson, and most of our congregation knows that there are more Baptists than people in the state of Mississippi, and a lot more Baptist churches around there, so I know that you probably view yourself as being in a lot of competition with the other churches. There's some other large churches there in Brandon, and tell us some of the things that you do to compete with the other churches there and bring people to your church.
Well, we give money away every Sunday.
That's good. That's very effective. That's very effective.
So it's good for the growth of the church. And I think we all understand that there is no competition. We're all on the same team. We're all trying to do the same things. And the reality is we're not going to reach them all. unless we work together. And so that's really the approach we're taking.
Yeah. I know that's what you're supposed to say. I know. But why don't you tell us about an experience your church had with First Baptist Church of Brandon, a large church that's very near your church in your same town. Why don't you tell us about an experience that your church had with First Baptist Brandon?
Well, they were going through a difficult time in their church and struggling, and I got together with a few of our men, and I said, you know, quite often we'd be excited about this in Baptist circles, and what we would do is hope that they fall apart and then pick up all the good people from their church. And I said, rather than doing that, why don't we go over there? They were having an afternoon meeting basically to decide the fate, the future of their church. I said, why don't we go over there and get on the edge of their parking lot, and why don't we just pray the whole time they're in that meeting? And I went over there that afternoon, Sunday afternoon. It was actually a cool day in Brandon, and expecting 30 or 40 guys maybe to show up. We had close to 300 men who came, and for just about 2 hours, we stood there and just prayed over that facility and over that meeting going on inside, and God moved.
Now, students, I want you to understand why we have a man like Tony Lambert here. It is not because he's the pastor of a big church, although he is. It's not simply because he's an excellent preacher of the Word of God, and you will see he is. It's not simply because he's a passionate soul winner who loves to tell people about Christ. You can't build churches like that and not be a soul winner. He is that indeed. But do you see the heart that Brother Tony has? When's the last time that you went to a troubled church in the midst of their troubles and prayed for the people of the church and for the pastor? That's the kind of heart that Baptist pastors need to have. We are not competitors. Our competition is not one another, it's the devil.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest fight is not the fight against another Baptist, the biggest fight is the fight against sin.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't just say that. We can't just know that in our heart. It's time for Baptists to express that common love that we have for one another and to express in tangible ways who the enemy is and what we can all do to work together about that. Brother Tony, for having a heart like that, we are grateful and we are honored to have you with us in our chapel this time.
Let's
turn our hearts towards worship and prepare to hear a message from the Lord, from His Word.
Genesis 16. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maid whose name was Hagar. So Sarai said to Abram, "Now behold, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Please go into my maid, perhaps I will obtain children through her." And Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. After Abram had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Abram's wife Sarai took Hagar the Egyptian, her maid, and gave her to her husband, Abram, as his wife. He went into Hagar and she conceived, and when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress was despised in her sight. And Sarai said to Abram, "May the wrong done me be upon you. I gave my maid into your arms, but when she saw that she had conceived, I was despised in her sight. May the Lord judge between you and me." But Abram said to Sarai, "Behold, your maid is in your power. Do to her what is good in your sight." So Sarai treated her harshly, and she fled from her presence. Now the angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness, by the spring on the way to Shur. She said, "Hagar, Sarai's maid, where have you come from and where are you going?" And she said, "I am fleeing from the presence of my mistress Sarai." Then the angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress and submit yourself to her authority." Moreover, the angel of the Lord said to her, "I will greatly multiply your descendants so that they will too be too many to count." The angel of the Lord said to her further, "Behold, you are with child, and you will bear a son, and you shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has given heed to your affliction. He will be like a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand will be against him. And he will live in the east, to the east of all his brothers." Then she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her. says, "You are a God who sees me," she said. "Have I even remained alive here after seeing him? Because of him, I live and he loves me." Darkness falls and the light becomes a distant memory. My heart grows faint, my foundation quakes beneath me. You are there, my God, the source of all my peace. You are the God of creation, yet your eyes see me. The caverns of my soul, often touched by dim despair. A heart uneasy and heavy with life's care. You see it all, your heart breaks for all my sorrow. You are my tomorrow. You are the Lord, the Almighty One. You hold me in your perfect will. You the world. painful curse for my soul. When I was sinking down, when I was sinking down, when I was sinking down beneath God's righteous frown, Christ laid aside his crown for my soul. Christ laid aside his crown for my soul. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. I will sing. While millions join the hymn, I will sing. And when to death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on, I'll on. Through eternity, I'll sing on, and through eternity, I'll sing on. I love you, Lord, and I live.
Our desire that what he hears from us, not just when we're singing, but every moment of every day, that it would be a sweet, sweet sound in his ear. Do you agree with that? All right, those of you that are still awake, do you agree with that? Let's try it again. All right, Tony, you should be up here doing this, man. You could wake them up. You know, this is about my fourth time, I think, to speak in chapel over the years, maybe third time. I did have to miss one. I look at Dr. Shaddix because he's threatened me that I'll never be able to speak again if I do that again. But I got to thinking about it. You know, I could remember standing up here the first couple of times, I suppose, as most people are, and just being scared to death. And I got to thinking about that as I was driving down last night. You know, really, what was I scared of? And I think probably initially it was probably a lot of the professors, you know, whom I see as my peers. In many ways, in fact, a lot of your professors I actually went to school here with during the master's program, and then I got to thinking about that. I said, well, it's really not those guys because I served for, I guess, 7 or 8 years as a trustee and was on the instruction committee. So I kind of hired these folks, about 80% of the guys who are here. And I got to thinking about, you know, it really is you, the students, that kind of intimidate me. Because, you know, you're right here. I mean, it's as good as it's going to be. You're learning. You're growing. You're digging in. You've got, I want to be careful how I say this because you'll think I'm a liar, but you've got more time right now than you'll ever have in your life. I know you don't believe that. I didn't either. And I remember hearing guys tell me that when I was in seminary, and I said, you're an idiot. And I know how you feel about that. But the truth is, as far as spending time in preparation, you've got the time now. You're being made do it. You get out there on the church full time, they won't make you do it. In fact, they'll try to get you to do anything but spend time with God. And I got to think about that, and so I know that you folks are kind of intimidating. I'm checking in last night, and the gal over there says, "Hey, what are you going to be preaching on tomorrow?" I said, "Well, I think I'm going to be preaching on Philippians 3. And she said, "Well, I just did a hermeneutical paper on Philippians." I thought, great. Would you mind staying home, you know? And that's kind of intimidating. I mean, here I am, a pastor, just trying to figure out what hospital I'm supposed to be at, and you folks are spending time digging out nuggets from Philippians. And then I'm the guy that's supposed to preach. And that's why I said, "Tony, you need to be up here. You need to be doing this." But I look around this room, and there are several students that I know, fewer than I used to. They when I left the big church, they kicked me off the trustee board and wouldn't let me do that anymore. And well, not really. I moved states, so they kind of have a Southern Baptist thing about that. But I hope to get back maybe one day if they'll allow me. And I do count it a privilege to be here. Thank you. Thank you for showing up today. It'd have been okay with Dr. Shaddix and Dr. Kelly, but it's a lot better with the rest of you. And I pray that God has something for you today. I've asked Him to use me. I've not come today with what we pastors call a sugar stick. Dr. Shaddix accused me of doing that, but I didn't come with that. I came with what I believe is a word from God for you today. And I pray that you'll be open to that. If you brought a Bible with you, let's go to the book of Philippians this morning. I'm going to focus on the third chapter. And I will tell you that today is going to be a little bit of a testimony for me, as well as sharing with you that word that God's given me. I believe in preaching what's hot on your heart, what God's doing in your life. The last time I stood on this platform, I spoke very boldly to the student body here at New Orleans, and I said, you know, here I had been a pastor in Omaha, Nebraska. I was there 10.5 years. In some ways, the Camelot of my life, the Camelot of my ministry. It was just wonderful. It was glorious. I can't say enough good things about it, and I so appreciate Dr. Kelly just even giving me the moment just to reflect on that a little bit. But there I was in a place that I loved so much, and God began to do something in my heart. God began to stir. The truth is, it was in a prayer meeting with Dr. Shaddix and Wayne Barber, who's now at Hoffmantown out in Albuquerque. And forgive me for saying this, but Jim and Wayne and I were in that prayer meeting, and we were on our knees because we all fell. That's right at 2 years ago, I think, was it not, Dr. Shaddix? We were on our knees in a room at a conference together, and we all felt God was stirring us, and we couldn't understand it. We all were being blessed. There was nothing wrong in our lives. Everything just looked wonderful. In fact, we all three felt rather guilty for whatever it was that was going on in us. But we felt like God was stirring us. And literally, in a matter of months, God would take all three of us and change to some degree our lives and ministries. And it's been a wonderful journey, but who would have ever thought that God would change mine so radically and so dramatically? I was born in this city, in New Orleans. My parents are both from Mississippi. So I grew up in Mississippi, pastored in Mississippi for 14 years prior to going to Nebraska for 10.5 years. And just to make a short statement here, I was not coming back to the South. In fact, as I stood here about a year ago, I said to this student body and to the administration, to the faculty and staff, I said, you know what, I want to challenge you to get out of the South. I mean, you're talking to people who've heard it thousands of times already, and they're not going to do anymore. And I said, get out of here. God's alive in other places in the South. And man alive, is it ever true? Be careful what you say. Because God began to deal with my heart. You see, I'd made a statement. I had said, God, I just want you to know something. I thank you for setting me free, for getting me out of the South, God, getting me out of all that tradition and all that garbage and all that stuff. And I said, God, I just commit to you right now. I'm never going back to Egypt. I'm just not going back. And that's how I saw the South. And God began to stir in my heart. Now, I share that with you kind of from a testimonial perspective to tell you where I'm going this morning and what God's done in my life. If you're in Philippians chapter 3, a lot of you in this room, I feel very silly telling you the context of this book, written about A.D. 61, somewhere roughly in that time frame, by Paul. And yet, it was one of those letters he wrote as he was in prison. And yet we refer to this letter, this epistle, as the epistle of joy. There's 16 times, I believe, if my memory does not fail me, which often it does, where Paul uses a form of the word joy in this letter. Now that's some irony, wouldn't you say? That here a guy is in prison, and yet he writes this thing that we refer to as an epistle of joy. And as I've studied this letter again in preparation for this message today, one of the things that jumped out to me that I don't know that I've ever noticed before was that really what Philippians is, it's kind of a long thank you note. I never really picked up that before, but that's just kind of how I see it. Now, you'd almost say that with authority, and so I'm just as right in that opinion as you are. And I think it's a long thank you note. And in fact, we know that's how he starts out the letter. And in the midst of that thank you note, he writes some encouraging words. And he gives his own testimony of what God has done in his life, of who he is in Christ, and the power that that brings to his life, literally the authority that it brings to his life. Well, as I thought through that, I said, okay, God, I need to understand where he's going here, because he's writing a thank you note full of encouragement that is literally the key to the joy. A guy in prison, a guy probably about to die, certainly in his mind, he thought it's all over, he's fine with that. But how does he express all this joy in that kind of situation? All of you that are in ministry, and I assume that's most everybody in this room, well, in fact, if you're saved, you're in ministry. You may not know it, but you are. God's called you to that. You don't have to be on staff to be in ministry. If you're saved, you're in ministry. Ministry is a reconciliation. We all are. And yet we all know that ministry and life in general is not always joy. Last Thursday morning, I'm going to USM the Nebraska football game. I've got 16 people going with me. I'm excited. I'm pumped. We're taking the whole day. We're going to just party, have a great time. My dad calls me 8 o'clock in the morning. I'm in the office preparing last minute. He says, son, drive to Hattiesburg. Meet me at Forest General Hospital. Your mother's been run over. That's all he said. Now I want to tell you something. Those are sobering words. I don't know what would go through your mind, but I'm seeing my mom in this mangled mass, you know. I get to the hospital, and sure enough, I walk into where she's being x-rayed, and they won't let me in the room. My dad's back in the waiting room, and I hear my mom screaming. Now, the great news is she's okay. She's fine. And it's going to be a long day. She's got 4 breaks in her pelvis. She's not fine, but she's going to be okay. There's no internal organ damage, those kinds of things. But you know what? That was not fun. And since Thursday, I've been living my life in limbo, back and forth. I'm an only child. My dad's staying at night. I'm staying during the daytime. I'm also expected to do a little work in Jackson, Mississippi, there at our church. You know, I mean, life's kind of complicated. That's not fun. How do you have joy in that? I think that's what Paul gives us in this little epistle, Philippians. He shows us at least some of the keys to that joy. I broke the book down. In fact, I just did this yesterday. I don't know that I'm correct, but again, this is how I see it. In chapter 1, he says, you know what? You learn that suffering brings joy. In chapter 2, he says, you learn that serving brings joy. In chapter 3, he says that you learn that sacrifice brings joy. And in chapter 4, he sort of wraps it all up and he says, and with all that comes great satisfaction. Now, there's a neat little outline, I think, and I really believe you can find scriptures to back up those things I shared with you. But if we focus on chapter 3 just for a few moments, remember, sacrifice. Sacrifice. Thursday night, instead of sitting at Eminem Roberts Stadium watching the Huskers thump the Eagles, and by the way, I have season tickets to USM games. It was going to be a good day for me either way. But rather than sitting in there, I had 15 people, 16 counting myself, had 15 people just 3 blocks away, and I could see the stadium lights from the window of the hospital. I didn't get to go to that game. Life changed. What are the keys? I sacrificed. You say, well, that's no sacrifice. Don't give me that spiritual response. If there's something that you love and you have to give it up, I don't care what the reason is you give it up for, it's a sacrifice. I'm kind of looking at my mom, and there were moments laying in that hospital or sitting in that hospital room. I'm looking at her in the bed. Of course, she's on all kind of medication. She doesn't know where she is. And I'm thinking, you know, I could sneak out for a little while. I could just go and get some peanuts and drink a Coke and just yell a little bit. At least I'd get the experience. That's flesh. That's selfishness. Now, I know you're all spiritual because you're at the seminary, but I'm telling you where those of us that are beyond seminary are. We're just fleshy. And so I'm battling with that, but that sacrifice. In chapter 3, as I've been referring to several times, in the first 10 verses, Paul bears his heart, he bears his soul, and he really tells us the power of who he is. I mean, in verse 10 that we all know so well, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. You know, really, that's the heartbeat of Paul. Paul just wanted to know Jesus, and he wanted to know Jesus seriously enough that he would make the statement, no matter what that means. If it means for me to sacrifice all that I have, all that I am, all that I love, then I'll do it if I can know Jesus Christ. Now listen carefully. That is a critical key to having joy in the midst of life. If your passion is Jesus, then everything else kind of falls into place. But when your passion is something else, you're always being torn between 2 and 3 and 4 and 50 worlds. When your passion is something else that you love, something else that you've elevated, whether it's family, a spouse, or children, or whether it's a ministry, or whether it's some form of recreation, or whether it's a sports team, or whether it's food, or whatever it is, if your passion is somewhere else, you're divided. And Jesus said, you can't have two masters. It just won't work. There's a couple of things that really jumped out at me, and I want to focus on verses 12, 13, and 14 of that third chapter. You know these verses very well. But listen to these powerful keys that Paul expressed in order to show us how to have joy. Look what he says in verse 12. He says, not that I have already obtained it or have already become perfect, but I press on in order, look at this, but I press on in order that I may lay hold of that for which also I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. Now I want to pause right there for just a moment. And I want to tell you what God said to me. I think the key here for Paul in this whole thing of sacrifice is that he had what I call a holy dissatisfaction. A holy dissatisfaction. Now, you know, I've got a boxer. He's still a puppy. He's only about, he may be almost a year old now, but he weighs about 75 pounds. And I mean, he's just one big muscle. That's all he is. I mean, that's not true. He's slobber, too. So y'all ever been around boxers? I mean, they're the slobberingest things you ever seen. You just get close to them, you got to go take a shower. It's ugly. But, I mean, he's just one big muscle and then slobber everywhere. But, you know, my wife, she loves that dog more than she does me. There's no question. I'm not bitter. I'm okay. I really am. Just pray for me. But my wife made a huge mistake. We had that dog on dry dog food all its life so far. And my wife went and bought some of this meaty, expensive stuff. Wrong move. She put that in the dog's bowl. And now guess what? The dog will not go back to the cheap, dried dog food. Now stay with me here on this. You see, the problem is our dog realized that there was something better in life. And so now he's choosing. And I'm telling you, he will go days. You put dried stuff in front, he won't touch it. Now, he will eat the dried dog food if you put the meaty stuff on top of it. Because he kind of just takes one bite anyway and it's all gone. I mean, he eats the bowl and everything. You know, it's gone. Well, you've seen it in the cafeteria over here before. You know what I'm talking about. Well, and by the way, I know that reincarnation is not a real thing. But if it were, I have decided I want to be that boxer when I come back. I'll drive home. You know what? I've got 3 children and a wife. It works well that way. And I'll drive home, and my wife will be on the front porch with that 75-pound boxer in her lap, rubbing his belly. My wife never rubs my belly. We've been married 22 years. She never. Dr. Shattuck, does that? I don't want to know. Anyway. Deborah's doing this over there. She's just shaking her head. Why am I telling you that silly story? Our dog has a dissatisfaction with dry dog food. Why? Because he believes there's something better out there now. You know what? Sometimes I believe in ministry and in this Christian life, we have a tendency to get settled in where we are, in what we have. And we don't have that desire to move on with God. I see it all the time. You know, especially in an educational institution like this, you know, we get our degrees, we put our time in, it's kind of like, I'm done, been there, done that. Now I'm going to just go off and hang out and do ministry. And we don't have that drive to continue to dig in with the Lord. And I've learned now, last June was my 25th year in ministry. And I've learned that I need to dig in more now than I ever have in my life. In fact, I'm back in a doctoral program here. At least I think I am. I'm kind of on hold, time out. But I'm doing that just for the discipline to keep on. You see, Paul had, again, I call it a holy dissatisfaction. He said, you know, not that I've already arrived, not that I've already obtained it, not that I have everything, not that I'm the man, but I press forward. Now, I know you say, well, wait a minute. He said that he learned to be content in every situation. That was content with God. Content with your walk with God. That's right. Wherever God wants you, that is correct. But could it be that God has something for you that's beyond where you are now? Could it be that your goals are not the goals that God has? And here's a guy that if ever he could say, I've done it, I've experienced it, Paul could have. But he had that holy dissatisfaction that drove him, that he expresses there in that 12th verse. Not that I've already obtained it or already become perfect, but I press on in order that I may lay hold of that which for also I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. You see, Paul lived what I call a God-driven life. Now listen, I love Rick Warren and I love the purpose-driven concepts, but I would rather be God-driven rather than purpose-driven. Let me explain what I mean by that. I think sometimes we've taken that and we've instituted what I would call overkill in that find out what God wants you to do, set the purpose, set the course, and go for it. And don't be distracted. The only problem is, what if God wants to make an alteration 10 minutes later? Can He? Can He change your life? I'm preaching to myself. There I was in Omaha, Nebraska. I was in the mega church. My buddies were the mega church pastors. I had meetings and fellowships and opportunities. And God began to stir in my heart. I do think it's because Dr. Shaddix prayed for me. I'm still mad at him. But God began to stir in my heart. And God began to put in me, listen to me, this is not me. I fought God every inch of the way. God began to put within me a holy dissatisfaction. You see, where I was wonderful. But I couldn't understand that God had something better. It doesn't mean the church is better. It does not mean the place is better. What it means is what God wants you to do is better. It's more satisfying. It's more fulfilling. And I fought God and I argued God. You don't leave a church running 4,000 in worship to go to a church running 1,500 in worship. You don't do that. That's not the Southern Baptist way. We climb the ladder. We go bigger and better. You don't leave a place where there's very little tradition, where you don't have to fight the rules and regulations and go back into the hotbed of all that. You don't do that. That's spiritual ministerial suicide. But God put in me a holy dissatisfaction. And He finally brought me to a place. He said, Tony, He said, you can have this ministry or you can see My glory. Which one do you want? And I don't know where you are this morning, but is there something stirring in you? Maybe you're a professor. Maybe you're a seminary president. Maybe you're just a student just beginning. Is God stirring something in you? And are you willing for God to place in you a holy dissatisfaction? You may be at the pinnacle of life. This may be the best you've ever seen. Are you willing to trust God to know that if He's leading, if He's directing, it does not matter what you give up? The sacrifice will be worth it because there will be ultimate joy. You know what I've seen in 25 years of ministry? I'll do this quickly. We fight so hard to keep what God gave us anyway. I watch people in ministry that are so territorial. I watch staff members on my own teams so worried about taking leadership from this place to this place. We're all fighting. And folks, wouldn't it be much better if we just turn to the Lord and say, God, how do you want to do this? Sometimes we get so structured, so organized, And you know what else I've seen? I've caught myself doing. We spend so much time trying to keep our image intact so we can keep what we have. My word, can you imagine what God could do through us in our ministries, in our homes, in our families, if we quit trying to look good to everybody else and just be led of the Spirit? Holy dissatisfaction. And look in verse 13, he says, this will go quickly, brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but one thing I do. I love that phrase. One thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead. Paul had a holy dissatisfaction, and he expressed a humble declaration. A humble declaration. Listen, this is arguably the greatest church planner that ever lived. Arguably the greatest Christian apologist that ever lived. Arguably the greatest evangelist that ever lived, apart from Jesus, of course. And listen to what he says again. Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet. What? You see, Paul once thought he had it all together. Acts chapter 9, road to Damascus, remember? He had it all together. You go back and you read his pedigree as he opens up this passage. Hebrew of the Hebrews, the right tribe, Pharisee, right down the line. He had it all together. And Paul finally came to the place that he realized, without Jesus, who gives a rip? That's a theological expression, by the way. Without Jesus and Him guiding and the fresh touch from Him, what difference does it make if I have everything? Paul said, I don't see myself. I love the way he expresses this. He puts himself down on our level. He says, brethren, adelphos, it means common origin. It really means from one womb. And Paul was saying, look, I'm just like you. We're all from the womb of Jesus Christ. And I know you great theologians are saying Jesus didn't have a womb. He was a man. Spiritually speaking, from the womb of Jesus Christ. All right? We're all of that common origin. Paul said, you know what? Yeah, I got all the pedigree. I've got all the stuff. But it really doesn't matter. What really matters is that we're of Christ. He says, I don't regard myself to have arrived. I don't value myself. I don't esteem myself. A humble declaration. Could that be a key to joy? That we're not trying to impress everybody with what we know and where we've been and what we've done. Boy, I got caught up in that, serving in the church I did previously. In fact, may I give you a little tip? If God ever takes you from the ministry you're in now to another ministry, don't brag about the one you were in. It'll cause you a lot of pain. Testimony. Just move on. Move on. And I love this. He says, one thing I do. Now let me get this, and I've got to be quick because I'm going to get you out of here on time. But he says, one thing I do. The words he could use there would be the word hen or the word heist. He chooses the word heist here. It means one thing numerically. You say, why is that significant? Because if he would have used the word hen here, he could have said one thing essentially. Now, that's where Baptists are. Baptists are hen, one thing essentially. Let me explain that to you. It means Jesus is really important to us. Jesus is high on the priority list to us. And ministry and His calling and His directing and His leading in my life is very, very important. But Paul didn't say that. Paul said, Jesus, one thing, numerically, is all there is to my life. You remember how he said it? For me to live is Christ. One thing, not essentially. Don't tell me how important he is. In essence, he's all that really matters to you. Paul said the key, this humble declaration is that Jesus is everything. He's the only thing. And folks, we will continue to struggle. We will continue to fight. We'll continue to have battles with other people until Jesus is the only thing. One thing numerically, highly significant. And very quickly, in verse 14, he says, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. A heavenly dedication. Press. I press on. Pursue. Common word for a sprinter. A sprinter would pursue, press the goal. The word there he uses, goal, skopos, is a word, literally it could mean tape at the end of the race. And Paul's eyes were on the tape at the end of the race. He didn't look at the fighting going on over here. He didn't look at the sale down at Walmart. Paul didn't worry about whether it was deer season or not. Paul didn't worry about what the football team was doing. One thing, and he pressed toward the tape. And what was the tape? What was the goal? What was the prize? To know Him. To know Him. To be like Him. All that He desires. He was absorbed. He was consumed. And folks, we will never, ever know Him as long as we are distracted by all the other stuff. Now, let me just close with two quick thoughts. The other day, my wife and I were out for breakfast, and we were at a restaurant in Jackson called Primo's. We spend Friday mornings, kind of our date morning. Every Friday, we go to breakfast together. We were having breakfast. We came out of the restaurant. There was a guy with a pickup truck and a real nice bass boat behind his truck. Mississippi, very common picture. But what was a little odd is the guy was in the back of the bass boat, sitting in the parking lot. And that was not so odd. But he had his reel in his hand. Again, it's Mississippi, so I'm going with it. But then he was flipping his lure out in the parking lot. Now, I like to give people the benefit of the doubt, Dr. Kelly. I like to give everybody a second chance. So I look back, yep, he's flipping his lure out in the parking lot. I'm an optimistic person. But I believe with all my heart, he could have flipped that lure in that parking lot all day long and he was not going to catch a fish. How many of you agree with me on that? Is that the only thing you can agree with or agree on now? Here's what I want to say to you. If you're not where God wants you to be, you can do everything right. But you're not going to catch the fish. You can have the best equipment, you can be best trained, you can have the best attitude, the best heart, the best desire, and you can cry out to God. You've got to be where God wants you to be, in His will. And are you willing to sacrifice in order to do that? By the way, I've been in Egypt 13 months, Mississippi. I love it. I wouldn't go back to Nebraska if God miraculously said, go back, I'll change it, I'll make it just like it. I wouldn't go back for anything. How's it gone? It's been real tough. I don't know if you know this, there is a cultural difference between the Midwest and the South. But I have bought a pickup truck and I think I'm going to be okay. In the last 13 months, we've had 600 people join our church. In the last 13 months, we've baptized over 350 people. And in the last 13 months, God has given us $350,000 above our budget needs. We have purchased 160 acres of land right beside the Jackson International Airport. And we are in progress right now of designing plans for major relocation. Never would I have dreamed that God could do what He's doing in this place. But when you go with God, it's always okay. Father, I love You. I thank You for these students, for this school. God, I pray Your blessings on this place. God, Your hand is on this place. Lord, I love You and I love this place. And Lord, we ask You to continue in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before you leave, this is for those of you, student wives, I want those of you who are husbands to complete a sentence for me. If mama is happy, everybody is happy. One of the things that we do every year is sponsor a retreat for our student wives the Friday and Saturday of this weekend, this last of September, first of October. This is about the time when a lot of our wives experience the fullness of their homesickness and alienation, isolation by coming to this incredible city called New Orleans. It's a great time of encouragement. It's called the Level Lectures. Mrs. Jimmy Draper, Carol Ann Draper, will be the speaker. It is designed to be a tremendous encouragement to your spouse, and I want you to encourage her to be a part of it. Some free child care is available. You can see my wife right over here if you'd like more details. The Level Lecture, your wife will be a happier camper, and that means you will be a happier camper if you encourage her to be a part this weekend. Thank you. God bless.